Broadcasting live, and around the world.
Around the world.
From Cabana One, the only podcast that's all ball bearings. Your ultimate source for everything Fletch.
Moon River.
Whew. Thank you, Doc. You ever serve time?
Laker Jim and his beat reporters will stop at nothing to make sure Fletch lives forever.
Forever.
They don't shower much.
Ugh.
This is Fletchcast.
Thank you, Sammy, and welcome to Fletchcast. I'm your host, Laker Jim, along with two guys who still can't figure out what they were doing in Utah this morning, Jake and Big Bob. Welcome, guys.
I just got back actually from Trembling Hills, so...
No more sedatives in your life?
Yeah, and the nose just cleared up. I mean, I look so much better.
And hats off to Nikki, his wife.
For many reasons, allowing me to use our makeshift studio / her walk-in closet as my studio.
The way your voice bounces off those sweaters. Beautiful.
That's right, right.
Boys, this week we have a really special episode because it is dedicated to the aliases of Fletch. And the aliases of Fletch are a key component to Fletch maneuvering his way in and out of situations, gathering information. You know, so what we're going to do over this episode, we're going to cover both Fletch and Fletch Lives. We're going to combine them. We built a really nice...
It's like a prize wheel or something
Wheel, right. So we put all the alias names on a prize wheel and we'll spin them. And I guess we'll go in a rotation of, let's say, clockwise around the room. We'll each take one. And because the aliases are much more than just funny names. Sometimes there's a real person behind the alias. And what makes Fletch so smart and clever is that the aliases that he uses and the real people that they are, sometimes in the situation he uses them in, makes it all the more ironic. And you'll get what we mean as we get going. All right, guys, you ready to get started? All right, let's do this.
Yeah, I'm excited.
All right, why don't we spin the alias wheel? Give it a nice who wants to spin it first? Bob, you want to give it a spin?
I'll give it a spin. Come on, big money, and stop.
Arnold Babar.
Isn't there a children's book about an elephant named Babar?
Bob, why don't you take Arnold Babar? Why don't we start off with
sure. Okay. Arnold Babar, first and foremost, you know, we all know the scene. We all know that he goes to Jellyfinger trying to get information on Stanwyck, and we all know what happens. But the funny thing about it is there are a lot of similarities between the Babar character and Fletch himself. In my digging over the, you know, my life thinking about these kind of things, one, you know, assuming that one day this episode would come, Babar itself, based on a 70 book series started in the 30s. Started by a French author named Jean de Bronhoff, and when he passed away, his son Lament took over.
Two names I love, Jean and Lament.
yeah. So just the story itself. You tell me if this sounds Fletch to you or not. Much like Bambi, Babar's mother is killed by a hunter. That leads to Babar escaping the jungle and running off to the city to kind of educate himself, learn, and develop. Now, how often does the Fletch universe situation involve Fletch running from a woman being killed?
No, you're right. I mean, Confess Fletch is one, and actually several of the books. Yes, so I could see the correlation that you're pointing out.
What a disturbing backstory to a children's book.
Well, you know, that's always the case. So once he finally returns, the king of the elephants dies eating a bad mushroom.
He's dying for years.
Yeah, but I mean the very end, when he actually died, that was extremely sudden.
And because because Babar is so versed in the world, he gets made the next king.
Wait a minute, are you making this up? Is this real?
No, this is really what happens. So he gets made the next king, and then he goes on to marry his cousin, who I assume is Sally Ann Babar.
Right, of course.
Which is kind of weird that he marries his cousin and no one ever looks, you know, at that with any kind of strangeness, being it's a children's book. For one thing, as exercise or as recreation, Babar often plays tennis.
California Racquet Club?
And when he does play tennis, his tennis outfit is exactly the same as John Cocktolston. White polo, white shorts. He actually holds the racket in his trunk. There's also a book came out in 1971. It's called Babar and the Doctor. Now, listen, I didn't get time to read it, but I am sure this has to do with proctology.
Drop your shorts and bend over, Mr. Babar.
Of course, it has to be.
Honestly, if any of you are big Babar fans and have ever read this book, please, please, please call in our phone number, leave us a voicemail, and just confirm what we already are assuming, that Babar goes to the proctologist and gets a trunk up his ass and, you know, it says Moon River.
With that little nugget of information that, you know, Babar is often playing tennis, it's actually makes sense that he uses that sort of alias when talking to the doctor about the tennis club.
And that's really, you know, the extent of the Babar and Fletch similarities.
It's just a shame. It's just a shame that the king was probably just looking for a good time, bad mushroom.
All right. Good, well, good job. Let's jump right. There's a lot. Cause we have,
we have 24 or so. So we have a lot to cover here. Folks, stick with us
on the board. I'm counting 24. Yep. All right. So let's give it another
spin. So let's spin that wheel.
All right. Yeah. And we got Igor Stravinsky.
Igor Stravinsky.
Absolutely. Igor. Who's taking it?
Igor or Igor?
Who's taking that one?
Jake, why don't you give this one a try?
Igor Stravinsky, do you guys remember where this was in the movie?
Remind us.
If memory serves me correctly, I believe that's when he was calling Jim Swarth out, correct?
Yes. Absolutely.
This is Igor Stravinsky.
So Igor Stravinsky is a real character or a real person. Do you guys have any idea who he was?
No.
He was a Russian composer, pianist, and conductor. Born June 1882, died April 6, 1971. He is widely considered one of the most important and influential composers of the 20th century. So it's funny, I didn't know who it was, but it's funny to see that some of these names are a little bit more famous than others, and people still kind of goes over their head, you know.
And I wonder why Fletch chooses that voice he does.
Yeah.
A Russian accent would have worked better. But either way, it's a very funny.
Mr. Jim Swarthout, my name is Igor Stravinsky, and I'm calling about some ranch property I'd like to buy.
Good, Mr. Stravinsky. What do you have in mind?
But Igor Stravinsky, real.
Wow. All
right, let's give this thing another spin. I'm going to give it a nice little spin.
Yeah, maybe you take the next one. Whatever it is.
Ted Nugent.
That's classic.
Okay. Yeah. Ted Nugent, the Motor City Madman.
Yes.
Ted Nugent is a real person. It's the first alias that Fletch gives in the movie. He gives it to Alan Stanwyck on the beach.
I don't see how you can pass that up, Mr. Nugent. Ted Nugent.
Ted Nugent's a guitarist, a rocker, most famously known for Cat Scratch Fever, the song Cat Scratch Fever. Singer on that.
You know, I've heard of Ted Nugent a million times, mainly from Fletch, but I gotta admit, I don't know what songs he sings. And when you just told me that's amazing that he sings that song.
more recently, I think he's been more of a political person, very outspoken about gun rights and NRA and stuff like that. You know, they call Uncle Ted. That basically sums up Ted Nugent. I mean, he's pretty famous rocker.
I remember Cat Scratch Fever. Yeah, I remember that song. I dated a girl. Funny story. I dated a girl who actually had. I thought I didn't even know it was real until she said it.
Okay. What are the side effects of Cat Scratch Fever?
I don't know. apparently enough to tolerate me for a short period of time, but only a short period of time, because I think she dumped me like a month later.
Well, you know, wasn't anything you did.
I don't know.
Poor girl was sick.
Let's keep this thing going. Let's give this another spin.
Oh, Mr. Poon.
We got Poon. Yeah. Oh.
Okay. All right.
Classic.
Well, you know, as much as there was on Arnold Babar, over my searches over the years, not a ton on Mr. Poon.
Sugar, Mr. Poon?
No, never, never.
However, there are a few things I'd like to discuss. So according to the 2010 U.S. Census, Poon is the 7,308th most common surname in the U.S.
Wow.
4,564 individuals do have the name Poon.
What kind of a name is Poon?
Comanche Indian.
Bye. Comanche means enemy in the dialect of the Utes. Now, the Utes being natural enemies of the Comanches, the Utes, the people that many native tribes would fight.
I'm sorry. Did you say Utes?
Yes, and I'm gonna explain what a Ute is. So the Utes were a rival tribe, and you know, where would they be from? Of course, Utah.
Obviously, Mr. Poon gets hit in the nose. He's got the Band-Aid. He says the vice president.
Whack. Yeah. Blood.
Whacked him at the door. The vice president was George Bush Sr. was the vice president at that time.
Yes. George H.W. Bush. Absolutely.
That was great.
And then it also leads into another Fletch alias that really gets ignored often. Frida's boss.
I'm sorry. Who are you again?
I'm Frida's boss.
Who's Frida?
My secretary.
And that's a line that I've used to cover my ass so many times. Just that double talk is just so great. And I guess it deserves a mention. But yeah, Mr. Poon, without a doubt, one of the greatest of all time.
Oh,
and
sure.
All right, let's give this alias wheel another spin.
You want to go Jake this time? Whatever it lands on?
Yeah. Ooh, Jake, what name is that on? That's right between two.
Between Dr. Rosen or Harry Truman.
I think that's Rosen.
Obviously, that was something that Fletch made up. But Dr. Rosenrosen or Dr. Rosenpenis or just Dr. Rosen. But yeah, completely made up, but still a classic character when it comes to the movie itself. Not mentioned in the book, so exclusive to the movie. Hey, Jim, I was just wondering, in the script, was there mention of specific Rosens or was there just a Chevy ad-lib all of them? Or do you remember?
I believe in the final script. Now the script I have is the final script,
yeah,
which is the script that Chevy co-wrote, and I believe the Rosen dialogue is in there.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, and you know there are several that were on the wall, obviously in the directory, and that's what he's looking at. And it's funny because every one of them was Rosen, you know, which is
yeah, without a doubt. Great. Yeah. Yeah.
But as far as
may I help you, Doctor?
Oh, it's me, Doctor Rosenpenis. I'm just here to check out Stanwyck's file. Doctor Rosenrosen, I'm here to get to the records room. It's Doctor Rosen. I want to check the records room. Doctor Rosen,
real or not real? Not real.
Still, though, one of the most quotable scenes in the entire movie.
Oh,
he puts that poor woman through hell with what he's doing in front of her.
B1.
And makes her collate all those papers too. Let's give that spin another wheel. Or wheel another spin. Sorry. Oh. Don Corleone. I'll take that one.
Yeah, do it.
Mainly because not so much Don Corleone. I mean, we all know who Don Corleone is. You know, we're talking about the infamous, probably many people regard as the greatest American movie of all time, The Godfather, Don Corleone being the head of the Corleone family. Fletch mentions his two sons. Actually, he had three, one being Sonny and the other being Mike and Fredo. Listen, if you don't know the Godfather movies, then how the hell do you know any movie at this point? And how are you on a Fletch podcast? But yeah, you know, he beautifully kind of talks about the family and how sons are taking over the business and Mo Green's out of the Tropicana. It just all ties into a reference to the movie itself.
Right. He goes with the alias. It's not just a name. He continues with information that supports the Godfather.
Right. Trying to just, you know, stall for time because he has a gun to him. Now, the bigger thing to talk about in this scene is the mattress police. Okay. I'm going to ask you both a question. Mattress police, right. Real or fake?
We've always been trained to think it's real.
Yeah, same.
You think so? You know what? You're right. Mm-hmm. The Mattress Police are an actual state inspectors from the Bureau of Home Furnishings, according to the LA Times. Okay. They do have police powers. They can write citations for removing tags off of furniture and bedding. What they do, okay, when they go around to stores and warehouses, okay, I wouldn't say they're undercover, but I guess you wouldn't know who they are, okay? When they find a product in the shop or a factory that has no tag, their police powers take effect, and then they can write citations or violations, okay? That's what the Mattress Police do. They are real.
They are real.
But they're not...
Yeah, consumers can remove the tags. There's no law.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. This is...
Prior to buying it, the tags can't be removed.
Right. Just in case you ever wonder this or concerned, once you purchase whatever product has a tag and it's in your home, you are allowed to remove the tag. So that's a little bit of an inaccuracy for the movie itself. But I don't think that guy working for the landlord knew what the hell was going on anyway. But yeah, they're policing those tags being on a product before it's sold.
And also with another Don Corleone connection, the Alan Stanwyck mansion was the mansion that was used in The Godfather as well.
Yes, it was. Yeah.
You know what? I'm so glad you mentioned that because I sure didn't. The exteriors are used.
I think it's Hearst Mansion, isn't it?
Yeah. The exteriors are used with that big uphill driveway with all the beautiful statues and everything. Great call. Good team effort. Yep.
I know we're early, but I have got to give you kudos for your research. I mean, it is top notch today.
Oh, thanks.
He is a bear for detail.
Oh, thank you.
You really are. You are a bear for detail. Oh, my God.
Thank you.
This will all be edited out. Okay, let's see what Dylan's coming up next. John Cocktolston.
Oh, one of my favorite names.
Now I think there's a misconception as to what the actual name is. Is it John Cocktolston, John Cocktolston, John Cocktolston? Yeah, the honest answer is they're all right. Because Chevy delivers it in a different way every time he says it.
I'm John.
Oh, John. Oh, now, John who?
John Cocktolston.
Yeah, you're right.
He really puts a lot of emphasis on the cock.
Of course. Well, it's Scotch Romanian.
Well, it's an unusual combination.
So are my parents.
Now, a little extra bonus fact. If anybody out there has a Moe's Southwest Grill near them.
To the off-the-wall entree names and promotions. Moe's knows what people like.
Oh.
You can actually order a John Cocktolston quesadilla.
What a life-changing day it was for us when we discovered that, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I remember seeing that for the first time. I was like, oh my.
And in the description of it, it says, it says all the things that are in it. And it says at the bottom, definitely not an odd combination, which is, again, just great.
Wonderful.
If you read Fletch 2, that scene is... with the different names is kind of in that, but it's a different name, but the name changes.
Who is it?
It's John.
John who?
It's John. John Lev. I don't remember.
John Cocktolston.
Hi.
All right, let's give this another spin.
Yeah, let's keep on spinning.
Mary Poppins. I forgot about this one.
So, I'll take that one. So first and foremost, Mary Poppins, Peggy Lee Zorba. Now, Mary Poppins, not so much to talk about other than the fact that he's hanging from a gutter, drops down, much like the way, you know, Mary Poppins, infamous nanny, right, who could fly, magical powers. So, you know, he's actually in a maid's outfit. In Fletch Lives, we see such a wealth of three name characters. You know, maybe it's because it's in the South and everyone down here goes by first, middle, and last name, but Peggy Lee Zorba is the first one to lead us off. And not so much because it's in the South, but the movie opens and they're in a Greek restaurant. Now, Peggy Lee Zorba, of course, a reference to the 1964 movie Zorba the Greek. Okay. In that scene itself, Chevy is dressed as a cleaning lady. And they're a maid. I don't want to get the term wrong and put myself in a situation where I'm using the wrong terms, but a maid, for lack of a better term. In this scene, have you guys ever noticed that really rockin' cool opening song? And I don't know what it is. It's, I don't know if it's fault of mine or not, but just something to look back on. Again, he's in a Greek restaurant. It opens up. The Greek people are pretty much, I don't know if they're mafia or just crooked running a restaurant, but they're talking to some sort of accountant about cooking the books. And of course, Fletch is there dressed as Peggy Lee Zorba. He goes into the woman's restroom after he's observing and taking notes of what they're saying, because obviously he's going to write a story on what they're up to and the corruption in this restaurant. He's followed in by Uncle Kakakis. Uncle Kakakis, being from a different time, not condoning it, follows Peggy Lee Zorba into the woman's room and just absolutely gets a handful of ass. Just grabs Peggy Lee Zorba's ass. And,
"Hi, what's your name, little lady?"
"My name? Peggy Lee Zorba. Peggy Lee Zorba."
"You're cute.
Do you mind if I just freshen up a little bit? Splash a little water on my face."
"Whatever makes you feel sexy."
It's a reference to Anthony Quinn's character in the movie Zorba the Greek, Alexis Zorba. Obvious reference based on the movie because they're in a Greek restaurant and because it's one of the most famous Greek.
One thing I like about the Mary Poppins alias is he thinks of it so quickly. I mean, he doesn't know he's going to fall on top of a car and have to have an alias ready, you know, but the fact that he fell from the sky, landed on the car, they're like, "Who's this?
What the hell is that?
If it's a cop, kill him.
Hi, Mary Poppins."
It's just so quick.
That's true.
Witted by Fletch to put that together as a joke and an alias.
Listen, that's Fletch though, you know, grace under pressure.
That's a great scene. That's a great opening scene.
Yeah. Poor Uncle Kakis. His glasses are so thick. Tito's Vandis, I believe his real name. He's an actor from the 60s, 70s. He's just such a sweet old man, even though he's kind of, you know, being a local pervert. What he's up to is no good, but, you know, at least by today's standards and really by all standards, you shouldn't assault somebody that way. But such a sweet scene regardless. He's so in love at first sight with Peggy Lee, and poor Uncle Kakis just has no idea.
Feeling a little horny, Uncle Kakakis?
Absolutely. Either way, let's keep spinning that wheel.
All right, Bob, you give this one a spin.
Oh, me? All right, I'm going to spin it the other way.
All right. Ooh.
Yeah, not as strong as I thought it was.
I don't think it's supposed to go that way.
No, it's supposed to go all the way around, too. It's supposed to go all the way around. I'm pretty embarrassed.
Arias Truman.
I'll take this one. I mean, this is pretty obvious. We know where Harry S. Truman was. He works for Casewell Insurance. When he comes to Marvin Stanwyck, and, you know, as he says, his parents were big fans of the former president, and he dropped the big one. And he dropped two of them, actually.
He dropped two big ones. Yeah. Well, you know what?
Good old Marvin.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but this is the first alias that the guy recognized
the
name.
They actually have a discussion about it. Yeah.
You're right. You are correct. Yeah.
Right. So he has to have a backup story in case he gets figured out.
I guess he could say that about any of his aliases, that his parents were big fans.
That's true.
Yeah.
So we know that Harry Truman was the 33rd president from the mid 40s to 1953. He was actually FDR's vice president. He was born in 1884, died 72, became president when FDR died. I think he's most famous for ending World War II because of dropping the big ones.
Yeah. He was a good man.
Sure was.
He showed the Japs a thing or two.
Oh, yeah. He dropped the big one, huh?
He dropped two big ones on him. He was a real fighter.
Yeah. I'm sure he did.
I love it. It's like he hits the pothole. You hit the pothole. Boof.
You know, they ought to recall these things. You hit one good bump out here and boom. Whole rear window explodes.
I love, and also totally random, when he tries to drink out of the glass with the straw. The straw is upside down.
Oh, straw! That straw is just a mess. I feel like the straw is like melting in the heat too, the way it bends.
Well, no, because he has the short part underneath, so when it floats up, the long part floats away from his mouth.
California, San Bernardino.
And I ask, you know. One last thing about that scene that I love, and I use this line all the time when she's trying to show him more pictures. When he says, "No, I'm trying to quit." I just love the delivery of that. That's such a great delivery.
So there's Harry S. Truman.
All right, Jake, give this one a whirl.
Yeah. All right, let's keep on spinning.
All right, here we go. And boom.
Try to make it go all the way around. I'm like, that was embarrassing.
Geometry Fletch. I forgot about this one. This is not a lot to it, but it's a funny one because it's obviously a a comeback to calculus from Fletch Lives.
I be calculus entropy. You be Mr. and Mrs. Fletcher?
I be Fletch. Geometry Fletch. She be Miss Trigonometry Ross.
Oh, please, I'm sure.
So obviously carrying on with the mathematic first names. And actually, like, not that long ago, I don't know if you guys heard, somebody actually named their son Scientific Map.
Interesting.
Let's give it. I'll give this one a spin. Billie Jean King, Bug Busters. Bob, you got to take this. It's a Fletch Lives one.
Oh, Billie Jean King Busters. Billie Jean King, of course. Yeah, yeah. One of my favorites. One of my favorite characters. I love the scene itself. Of course, Billie Jean King, a reference. First of all, once again, being in the South, three names. Billie Jean King, of course, being the number one ranked tennis player with 39 Grand Slam titles, 12 in singles, 16 in women's doubles, and 11 in mixed doubles. Just a legend. You know, before the Williams sisters, Venus and Serena Williams, came along, Billie Jean King was the talk of the town in women's tennis and tennis in general. The biggest takeaway, though, not to disparage her struggle or her life, was that she married somebody.
It's funny.
The Bug Busters scene itself, though.
It's so fantastic. It's so fantastic.
So much to talk about that I could spend an episode on. You know, there's a bit of a Deliverance reference in there where with the squeal like a pig. The fact I love when he tells the guy to smack his head from the side and this side. And I love the way the guy's comb over goes flopping over when he does it. And he leaves him there. Again, he's using the novelty teeth in that scene. The funny accent he uses, the word deplaning, just one of the best scenes. You know, if you're looking for a funny scene to watch on YouTube and you're looking up Fletch Lives, that's one of my go-tos all the time. You know, and he managed to find the queen.
You know, they multiply by masturbation.
All right, spin it again. Ooh, G. Gordon Liddy. Well, actually, you know, we make the common mistake of saying G. Gordon Liddy, but the alias is actually just Gordon Liddy.
Hey, do us a favor, pal.
Name's Liddy. Gordon Liddy.
But the true person behind the alias is G. Gordon Liddy. Now, G. Gordon Liddy was the chief operative in the Watergate scandal.
Right.
He was convicted of several crimes, including conspiracy, burglary, illegal wiretapping. They famously burglarized the Democratic National Committee headquarters and served 52 months in prison. And then after that, became a pretty popular political radio talk show host.
From Washington, D.C., Radio Free D.C., with G. Gordon Liddy.
And it is I, G. Gordon, known irreverently to some as the G-Man, and this is Radio Free D.C., the G. Gordon Liddy Show, and we're good to go and ready to launch.
That's where the money is.
Gordo! Back here?
Don't tell me my business, boy. Just checking the luggage.
How many? I wonder how many are left. Let's see. Let's keep spinning. We haven't got a duplicate yet.
We haven't got
a duplicate yet. And the next one up is Nostradamus.
We're really powering through. We are.
Nostradamus.
I'll take this one. I mentioned it earlier. So, you know, this is a great scene in Fletch Lives. So
please do,
funny.
Buddy.
I just think this whole scene is hilarious with the woman that just had her nose job
on the airplane.
So funny.
She is a scene stealer, that lady.
His name is Nostradamus. Oh my gosh. And then she says,
Nostradamus. I love the font in Irish.
So we know that Nostradamus was a real person.
Yes.
Lived in the 1500s. He was a French astrologer, most famous probably for his book Les Prophets or something like that. It's called. There were over 900 poems.
Yeah.
And they claim in quotations, claim that he predicted the Great Fire of London, the French Revolution, Hitler, Napoleon, the World Wars.
9/11.
Yeah,
9/11. So
he's a scary son of a bitch. But again, if you make vague references,
anybody can
pick and choose how it refers to the world.
Exactly.
But the scary thing is how it's so accurate to the year in so many cases. But yeah, go on.
Well, that was about it. So, but that's Nostradamus. Yeah. Yes, he was real.
All right, I stopped that last wheel. Oh, this one, Bob, you got to take this one. Peter Lemongello.
Oh, yes, that's your alias.
That was Bob's name on the old Moon River message board was Peter Lemongello.
Bobby Ralph? Peter Lemongello, your house is on fire.
I love the name Peter Lemongello. Anybody want to guess out of the top 15 where Lemongello lands for favorite flavors?
It's got to be top 5.
I'm going to say top 10. I was going to say top 10. It sounds like it's not.
No, barely cracks the top. It's 14. What? Ranked right above pineapple. The top
I never
five
heard of pineapple.
I will give you the top 5.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah, pineapple's 15th. It falls pretty low. I guess it's just too strong a flavor. But again, the name is just a made-up name, not real, not based off of anybody historically. But I love the name so much because it's just such a funny throwaway scene, the way he walks into the control center and takes over, the way he lies to Bobby Ralph about his house being on fire. And that poor son of a bitch probably lost his job and ran home. Probably thrilled to find out that his house was not on fire and his family was safe, but probably also so destroyed with the fact that they fired him based on what happens when he leaves his post.
That's a really funny scene too. He just kind of walks in and nonchalant says, "Your house is on fire." And then everything that precedes, everything that comes after that, as far as, compulsive gambler, but he was actually,
Ted?
He had hemorrhoids,
Is that Tibu Ted or is that somebody else?
No, that's Tibu Ted.
Yeah, that is Tibu Ted. Poor Tibu. Yeah, good Lord, Tibu, put your pants back on.
But Bob, I will just interject one little thing. Peter Lemongello is a real person. Peter Lemongello. He
You're
is a singer.
Kidding.
Yeah, there's a singer. He was a 70s cabaret singer named Peter Lemongello. Yes.
Get out of town.
And he had,
Fletch, get out of town.
he had a hit album called Love 76.
You are about to witness a new dimension in entertainment. Peter Lemongello.
Oh, I could have been a million things.
Peter Lemongello, a mood rock experience called Love 76. Yes, Peter Lemongello has created a new kind of music that's both romantic and moving. Just listen.
Come close.
In this two-album package, Love 76, you'll experience all the warmth and tenderness living in the heart of Peter Lemongello, plus the excitement that is Peter Lemongello on stage.
How did you know and Bob didn't know? Are you a cabaret fan?
I do love cabaret. You know that. That was a loaded
question. Well, I know. That's true. That was a dumb
loaded question. But
right now,
yes, go to peterlemongello.com. I'm sure it's more active than Fletch1.net.
Yeah, I never knew. I'm humbled and embarrassed.
I had such high accolades for you at the beginning of this podcast, Bob, and then you totally botched Peter Lemongello.
Yeah, I just shit the bed.
You did. You
Listen,
set the bar
yeah
high.
He came out of the gate of the bar. Yeah.
So maybe when you started in the message board all these years, maybe LJ thought, wow, this guy really likes that cabaret singer.
When you say LJ, do you mean Laker Jam or Lemongello?
Yeah. Oh, that's true. Either or. They're interchangeable.
Well, you know what? Maybe Bob, what happened was you spelled Lemongello wrong. Because lemon jello is spelled with a G.
That's the reason why.
Lemon.
That's jello. The reason why.
That's the reason why. Because when you think jello, you think J-E-L-L-O.
You know, I'm going to have to circle back to this and re-edit this podcast and suddenly know all about Peter Lemonjell. I'm going to need about 40 minutes to research. I'm hoping you guys don't mind. Man!
We don't have that kind of time. All right, let's spin the wheel.
Victor Hugo. Let me do that one because I saw that one a little while ago. So we know Victor Hugo from what? Does anybody want to take a guess?
He's an author, right?
Yes. He wrote Les Miserables. You know, everybody knows the famous, you know, the musical, but yes, he was the one who wrote the novel. He was a French poet. He was an essayist, a playwright. And Les Mis was, I wrote this down, talking about the social injustice of 19th century European society, with focus on sufferings of the poor. So everybody knows about Les Mis and Victor Hugo.
Why am I drawing a blank when he says it? I can picture him saying it. Victor Hugo. Why can't I picture where this is in the movie?
You're right. I can't remember either. I had it on top of my mind when I was writing it down last night, but I can't remember what it was.
It's got to be Fletch Lives, right?
Oh, I know where it was. I know it.
Where?
He was in the cell with bend over.
Oh, of course.
You're right.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's right. Victor Hugo.
It's so overshadowed by the bend over line. That's right. Bend over. Ben,
yes,
Victor
that's
Hugo.
It. Good. Okay, got it. I knew I thought of it last night.
Good call. All right, we figured it out. Oh, Baba Aram. I'll take this guy.
I know that you're a wealth of knowledge when it comes to Baba Aram. So yeah.
Yes, I told you guys I had started to prepare this information prior to even knowing we were gonna do this episode. So Baba Aram, as we obviously know, we never know it in the movie. He's never referred to as that. But that is the guru character that Fletch plays at the very end of the movie. He's on the roller skates. He's got the beard. He's got the bald head and the robe. So Baba Aram, and we know that from the ID on the cover. On the cover or the poster, on one of the Fletch IDs, it says Baba Aram. So that was actually based on a real person, Baba Ram Das, who was a California guru as well. He was somebody that he's known for the book, the best-selling book, Be Here Now. He was a spiritual healer, and he helped kind of popularize Eastern spirituality. And there's actually a Netflix documentary.
Really?
About him. Yeah, it's called Ram Das Going Home. And he looks exactly like Fletch in the movie. The beard, the bald head, the robes. It's almost identical to the way Fletch looks in this scene.
That.
And yeah, it was based on a real guy.
I'll be honest, that's the one alias that I knew nothing about.
Yeah.
Nothing going into it.
And he never uses the name though, does he?
I'm sorry. You have to excuse me. That's the second alias because obviously I didn't know anything about Peter Lemongello too.
Well, now you do.
That's very intentional.
No. He never says it in the movie. He never names himself. He just the ID on the cover.
Was the Baba Aram person in real life? Was he big on roller skates or was that just like an added twist?
I don't think so. I think roller skates was Fletch's little twist on it.
Well.
All right, let's give this thing another spin. And we're going to land on Eldridge Cleaver.
Oh boy.
I'll do this one. So,
Jake?
Yeah. So, Eldridge Cleaver, real person. He was an American.
Real person. But the alias, not delivered by Fletch. It is Fletch's alias, but it's delivered
That's right. They were in the morgue, right? Weren't they in the morgue when that happened?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. With Bend Over. Yeah. American writer, political activist, and his big claim to fame was he was the early leader of the Black Panther Party.
Right.
So he was born in August of 35. He died in the late 90s. But that is Eldridge Cleaver. So real.
So the Black Panther, leader of the Black Panthers, a name that maybe in the South should have rung a bell to Bend Over, but
yes,
no, but also it did ring a bell to calculus. probably yes, somebody you look up to. Right.
Paul Bendover was concerned with was tagging his toe and stealing his Laker
and watch. Yeah, that the loss of that Laker watch is such a you worry about continuity in movies and you worry about people getting their belongings back. I was always so panic stricken to think like he can't lose that watch for good.
But don't bother him. He's watching the Terminator.
We're getting towards the bottom of the barrel, not the bottom of the barrel, but the bottom of the list here. You know, we're running out of people.
Oh, Henry Himler.
Oh, Hank Himler.
Okay. Yeah, Hank Himler. Now that's an alias that's given during mm-hmm. the Ku Klux Klan scene of Fletch Lives. And Hendrich Himler, who he's nicknaming himself after, he was one of the most powerful men in Nazi Germany. And he was actually only second in power mm-hmm. to Hitler, was Hendrich Henry Hank right. Himler. You know, as we know from the movie, too, he's
yeah.
from the California
yeah.
Cleaver.
Yeah.
Who goes there? Henry Himler. What Clavin claimed you? California Clavin, Cucamonga.
And again, an alias that
totally
given to another claim
right, right,
should
exactly.
have been recognized.
Especially, yes, exactly. Something that they probably should have recognized.
Okay, let's give it another spin. Ed Harley. I love Ed Harley.
Yeah.
Ed Harley.
So,
Let
me do this one. I'll do this one. Okay. So we know where Ed Harley comes. He's at the bar in Fletch Lives. And Chevy mm-hmm. Fletch is really, really funny in this.
Absolutely. One of the best little voice acting scenes he does in the entire series. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's got a lisp.
Yeah. And then, of course, like you said, feel a little horny. I mean, that's a great line too. I love that.
We say that all the
time. So great. So, if you want any T-shirts or bumper stickers,
decals,
yeah. So Ed Harley is technically,
and
fake,
I love it.
But now the Harley Davidson. So there right. is a Harley, but it's not Ed Harley. It's actually William Harley. But didn't he say though that his granddaddy? Maybe there's
Davidson.
Yeah,
he screwed Davidson.
So maybe there's an. Yeah. I couldn't find an Ed Harley, but
yeah,
William Hardy was the one that obviously started the company. So
yeah.
Now was it two people named Harley
yes.
and Davidson?
Yes. Harley and Davidson. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So. You know, in that scene, one of the other lines that I abuse to death is whenever I see a blue car, I always say original blue. And I'll say something like, you in luck, white
you
boy,
can ride
original
that,
blue.
You can ride that low rider there if you want.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Nobody touches my hog.
I always say, like, your mustache look funny.
Yeah, you do say that a lot. Yeah.
A lot of mustaches look funny. That's why.
Yeah. I also love the lead up to that before Bendover gets there, the kind of the conversation he has with the Nazis from Nashville where he, you know.
Can I have a soda, please? Diet Pepsi or a tab would be good.
Hey, pussy.
Name's Ed. Ed Harley.
Yeah. Are you sure you're in the right place?
I think so.
Okay.
Fun fact about myself. I used to drink Tab all the time before they stopped making it. All the time. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Oh, wow.
I think they started making Tab again.
I hope they do.
Fun fact about Laker Jim and I where I grew up in New Jersey, I was next door neighbors with Laker Jim's mm-hmm. only Uncle Mike. And, you know, whenever Laker Jim would come over to my house, you know, swim, play basketball, whatever, we'd always, I mean, not always, but when we were younger, we'd always take a walk over to Uncle Mike, say hello. He was a Tab enthusiast and we used to constantly.
Oh, yeah.
A cool Tab.
Yeah. Cooler Tab. And we'd always ask him for a Tab and he'd, oh yeah, he's drinking all my Tab, you know, I'm going to start a Tab for all the Tab you're drinking. So shout out to Uncle Mike for always supplying us with
all
the
right.
best Tab in
shout
town.
Shout out Uncle Mike. All right, what do we got? We got three left. Hold on. All right, let's see if we can get this one. We got Claude Henry Smoot.
So funny.
Other than Claude Henry, I love Claude.
You know,
great hair, great mustache.
Also, you know, one of those names too that wasn't originally Claude Henry Smoot. He had to improvise. It was, doesn't he say Claude Henry Carlson at first, and then he changes it to Smoot?
No. Well, it's Claude or Claude.
Yeah.
Yeah, so who's taking that? Not a real character. I'll take it. Not a real character, only because we got to speed this thing up. Not a real character. Faith healer from the Farnsworth Ministry, obviously. You know, suffers from migraine headaches, as we know. And he got those intense migraine headaches. He was on his gazebo making some repairs. He was struck by lightning. Now he did receive the healing gift, but you know, still got to deal with those migraines all the time.
You know, yep. For every yin there's a yang.
Claude Henry, Claude or Claude, not real.
Not real.
Boom.
Right.
Oh, we got Bobby Lee Schwartz. Bobby Lee.
Schwartz. You know, Big Bob will take Bobby Lee. Not a lot. Again, not a lot on Bobby Lee Schwartz the second. Just again, it plays off of the whole three names in the South. Really not much. You know, he's, you know, we see Fletch standing in line, and we just like how when he's originally walking in the first time and he gives the Claude Henry Smoot name and the address of seven, he does the same thing, you know, where he's just giving fake names just to get it by. He is dressed as in costume as one of the, I don't know if it's a Confederate or a rebel or whatever the hell he is, but you know, it's just, again, it's just a throwaway name to get himself in the door.
Yeah. You know, I feel like these three named Southern aliases are names he's coming up as he's saying them.
Absolutely.
You know,
he's
literally putting the three words together.
When you say that, do you mean in terms of the Fletch character, or do you think Chevy Chase, the actor himself, is just doing it? Cause I could see it either way.
Yeah.
I could see it either way too.
Yeah. Not much to go on there other than that. Just a throwaway. Yeah. Unless you guys are going to tell me he was like the governor of the governor.
I was hoping you didn't Claude Henry Smoot me, because I was sure that had to be somebody, but it was.
Yeah. I did do a little bit of extra research on Schwartz, Bobby Lee Schwartz, and the name comes up, but again, nothing that would be like a tie in to anybody.
Now there's no reason to spin the wheel because we have one left, Elmer Fudd Gantry, and I will I'll take this guy.
Jump on it.
Yeah. So Elmer Gantry is a 1960s movie called Elmer Gantry. It's based on a novel about a fast talking traveling salesman who's basically selling religion to a small town.
Okay.
So it kind of fits into the whole like theme of Fletch Lives. It's a name that you would, you know, you could work in that makes sense with the theme and the religious overtones. And also he uses the alias in the Phil Hartman Bly scene. So he's a fast talking, he's a fast talking traveling salesman kind of guy. So that kind of all makes sense. And obviously Elmer Fudd, you know, the arch enemy of Bugs Bunny.
Baron, you are.
I are pissed. Some damn fool told me it was on back order and I'd have to wait. Whose signature is this? Who signed that? Well, that's the trouble. It's typical of a large corporation. Lack of communication, that's why I like to keep Everest small.
Oh, you're from Everest.
Now you're talking. Elmer Gantry, Elmer Fudd Gantry.
Well, Mr. Gantry, I'm not sure there's anything I can do.
Well, you could pull my file instead of standing there pulling your pud.
That scene is so funny, too.
With the Southern accent that Elmer Fudd, the cartoon character, has, it kind of works well with the fact that he's using the
Chevy's
same kind of
limping
accent
in that scene and he's pissing blood.
The white suit.
Oh my god, it's so
pissing
funny.
Pissing blood, bleeding. Five suits a day. Yeah, I love that scene. And a great Phil Hartman scene. He's so missed. He is so missed in the world, Phil Hartman.
Yeah, Phil was great. All right, boys. Well, we killed the aliases. That was really informative. Like a lot of that stuff I didn't really realize.
No, if you're listening at home, if you're listening at home, you're in the car, you're at work, you're listening. If you have things to add, again, that's why we have our phone number. Give us a call. Leave us a voicemail. Tell us what you know. Tell me that Bobby Lee Schwartz was somebody that I don't know about. But by all means, give us the info that we're missing, if you can. This is going to be an episode. Once it drops, we are going to definitely have a lot of activity on social media, like we said earlier. Some of the pictures we're going to post. Comment, like, you know, but definitely keep the conversation going on social media.
And that wraps up episode 10 of Fletchcast. Man, this was fun, the aliases. Join us next week for a special Christmas episode. There's only 2 episodes left in season 1 of Fletchcast. So if you haven't caught up, catch up. The last 2 episodes are going to be amazing. For Jake, for Bob, I'm Laker Jim. I'm going to catch the last 10 minutes of Dynasty. See ya.